Ευχαριστούμε τον σύντροφο Λίποβιτς για την άκρως ενδιαφέρουσα φασιστική τοποθέτησή του. Σειρά έχει τώρα να μιλήσει η σύντροφος Αχάνεκερ.
I'm very happy to be with you this night. My English is very limited. Even I have to speak every day with Michael English because he doesn't know Spanish. My vocabulary is limited. So you should understand that it's very different for me to speak in my language than to speak in this limited language. So I will try to give you my ideas with these limited words. I'm happy to be in Greece in this moment. We are coming to Europe. So in general, I have invitation to come to Europe and also America Latina. But I didn't want to come because I have so many things to do in a continent or subcontinent that is emerging, the fights, the governments, the new alternatives. But at least what we see of Greece in Latin America is the first country in Europe that began to fight against this situation, this model, this globalization, neoliberal globalization. And as we have been presented, I think we are militants or activists more than intellectuals. In my case, especially, I say that I am a popular educator, a person that wants the ideas to arrive to everybody, because I think that people with ideas and practice should change the world. So I'm going to be very practical in this. I want to transmit what happened in Latin America, what was the reality of our left in Latin America, and how in very few years this situation changed. We had two decades of neoliberalism that were the most horrible decades of our history. The 80s and the 90s. In that moment, poverty grows terribly. Unemployment was expanded. The structure of nature was terrible. I always say in Chile we had big forests, wonderful ancient forests, and the Japanese transnational cut every tree without seeding any other. Fragmentation of society was bigger and bigger. We had in the beginning, in the 70s, with Allende, we had very strong working class united in the industrial or minor centers. And these began to disappear, you know, the outsourcing, the flexibilization, the unemployment, all this produced, weakened very much the working class. All these decades has produced, was a real crisis, provokes suffering to much, was at the biggest, all the sectors of society, soft and elite, a very little group that profits, take advantage of the situation and accumulate richness, because one of the characteristics of neoliberalism is that rich people became more rich and poor people more poor, and the difference especially between the rich and the poor, whites. We were in Chile one of the countries more equal in the world, and now we are one of the more unequal. I say that this neoliberal system provokes not only economical suffering to many sectors of the society. If you see the worker, the industrial worker, the peasants, the informal sectors, the middle classes, everyone is affected, even the little the medium entrepreneurs, the medium bourgeoisie. But it's not only economical effects. We have the neoliberal causes psychological effects. People are not happy of living. They are running. They are running because they have the competence. Even if you are a successful professional, you are threatened that tomorrow perhaps you would not have work. So people have told me, successful professional architects, for example, they work 16 hours and they have no life with their family. Why? Because they think that if they don't work so much, the other architect could compete and get him out of the market. So the conditions that neoliberal creates is a wide malaise, a wide sensation of not happiness, the contrary of happiness. And it's the moment, the objective condition creates the possibility of having quite a lot of persons that could be motivated to an alternative model. But what happens? These objective conditions are not accompanied with the subjective conditions. Because, first of all, we had, I am speaking, these ideas were written in 2001. And you will see how it matches or not, and how we have overcome this. We have, first of all, a crisis of politics and politicians. Why? So people doesn't believe in Latin America, didn't believe in politics and politicians. First of all, our democracies, after dictatorship, changed. They began to be as Hinkelammers, Franz Hinkelammers, a German that lives in Costa Rica, says, limited democracies. The power of this democracy is not in the parliament. Who decides economical issues is the central bank that has been independent from the parliament, IMF and World Bank. Who decides about security? Not the parliament, the security institutions that are after. And there is the big power of the media. The media that forms the head of the people is controlled by capital, is concentrated property in some few hands, and they, and you know, and this is something that I have detected in this country, how the media has created a mentality that convinces people that the situation is what it is the best of all, and you have to accept that because it's the only way to go ahead. They say to us that in Latin America, they sell neoliberal as the solution for our poor countries. The problem is that after 20 years, people knew that there was not at all a solution, on the contrary. But this is, you know, Chomsky, the North American writer that says that democracy in this moment doesn't need repression because has the propaganda, the media, that makes the people support the system as the only one that could exist. So, really, our parliaments are very limited. Our democracy is limited, and people say, well, and then we have two other things that are very complicated. One is that our words of the left has been taken by the right. So the discourses of right and left people are very similar. They speak about structural crisis. Even in Brazil, the militants, the dictators, said they were the revolutionaries. So imagine. And but it's not that is the right that robs us the idea. But the problem is that our left politicians also practice the same way of making policy than the right. So you see a politician, the words are the same and the attitudes are the same. Personalism, clientelism, autoritarianism, well, all these kind of things you find in both politicians. These produce a very big skepticism from politics and politicians. In Chile, 800,000 young people doesn't go to inscribe themselves in the election because they don't believe in those politicians. Some people says, oh, the youth is terrible. The youth, the modern youth, has values, serve to rien, o sea, they don't, no sirven para nada. What you will say, somebody that translates from Spanish. Somebody knows Spanish here? Nobody? Yes? No sirve para nada en griego? Uh-huh. You understood? Okay. So, we need to convince the people, we need to change. This was very clear for us. The problem is that the ruling class, the dominant classes, has no problem with this. And no problem with this because they can work, and the dictatorship has demonstrated that they can work without parties, without political instruments. No, the people that want to change the world, we know that we need political instruments to change, and I will try to explain what would be the characteristic of this new way of doing policy, of the new culture. No? But this is one problem, the restrictions of democracy. Another problem is that we knew better what we didn't want when we criticized socialism. We criticized the social 20th century, but we didn't have an elaborated alternative to convince people that we have an alternative model of society. And this is something that is very important because people want to know, Michael always says, well, we cannot choose the way if you don't know where you go. No. We need to see the perspective of the society we want to construct. But in a moment, after the crisis of socialism, the defeat, we say, of socialism in the 21st century Soviet states, we had the problem of which alternative then? And we didn't have an answer. I think that you and us, we were all perplexed, you say, searching the solutions. But in Latin America, I have written the book that you have read in that moment. You know, my book was read everywhere. Los conceptos elementales del materialismo histórico, the elementary concepts of historical materialism. And people thought that I had the answer. I was a theoretician of Marxism. And I didn't have the answer. What I did in those years of perplexity was to put the microphone to experience in Latin America of local governments that began to do in practice a little new society in their municipalities. It was very important because there they were practicing, they were correcting our errors of the past and permitting to construct societies with transparency, non-corruption, and especially what Mike says, participation of the people in the decision making of the important things of the city, beginning by the budget. It was not the mayor and the technician that decided what to do with the budget of the city, but they convoked the people to discuss, to prioritize. And I always say, we were talking with the mayor here in Heliconia, we are the mayor of the beaches, yeah. And he says, well, here the mayor has very little budget. And we say to him, but you know, in Porto Alegre, the first participatory budget experience, 90% of the budget was employed in the machine of the state and paying salaries. But because of the practice of the people, this changed. And even if you have a little thing to do, it's much better to consult the people what to do with a little budget than to attend a big budget than to consult. No? So you can really involve people in decision making even if you have little budget. But these governments, these local governments, permits to demonstrate that the left could govern and could govern in a different way. And this was one of the carta de presentación, you know, when, Lula, when Lula went to, did his campaign to elections, he says, I have no experience of governing a country, but we have experience of governing these municipalities. See what we have done. Because people, each day more, don't believe, because of what I have said before, in words. They believe in practice. If we are able to do different practices, not only in the local places, in university, if we repeat the same practice of the past, a student federation that is separate from most of the students, that is dogmatic, sectarian, that are splitting every day, well, this won't convoke anybody. But if you have a different practice, if you go to attract all the students with the needs of the students, because we have committed the error in Chile of politicizing too much the student movement, and we lost the majority. In the agenda period, we were minority in the universities because of a bad policy. Not understanding that we have to convoke the people to do in the university or in the local or in the center we are, in anywhere places, a demonstration that we are able to construct a new society, democratically participatory, etc. No? In this practice. We have to abandon also, well, one of the problems of our left in the past was that they, and I am responsible of that, I have said in Athens, the concepts, we have concepts that didn't permit to see the society as it was. We copy external analysis of society, the alliance between peasants and workers in Russia, we apply to our countries. Our countries has different social standards. We had the indigenous who are not considered by us. We had the revolutionary Catholic theology of liberation, that was very important in our countries to permit the people, the poor people, to understand that you have to change the world.